Is the stove off? Is the cat out? Did I bring my cell phone charger? And what about my walking shoes? And did you get their phone number? Leaving on a journey, even a short journey, is a piece of work. If you've done the job properly, it's a relief to get going. If you haven't, the journey will be anxious and doomed to incompletion. Lent is a journey of preparation for Holy Week and Easter. Clay will guide you through that time of reliving those epic events of Palm Sunday, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, Easter Eve and Easter morning. And in the Christian story, they frame our understanding of life and death and life beyond death, life and death and resurrection. So Lent is the time to get our head and our heart ready for this. And there are some preparations to do. Some cats to be put out, some spiritual training needed. We used to do that by giving up things, like cigarettes when everybody smoked and Craven A was still good for your throat. Now you can not do chocolates or Twitter or watching the Paul Henry show. The point of giving up things that you like for Lent, and some people really do like Paul Henry, is to remind ourselves that the Christian life is more about letting go of the things we need rather than holding on to them. It's about reviewing priorities and constantly reordering them. And that is very hard. We prefer to keep on keeping on with the things we enjoy and grow accustomed to and think we need. Religious habits die the hardest of all, especially if words and music is involved. Replace Dimitri and his singers with a punk rock group next Sunday, and watch the firestorm rage. But a couple of times in the Christian year, we build in a journey of spiritual preparation and soulful refreshing. Advent, to prepare for Christmas. Lent, to prepare for Easter. And we use stories, not punk rock groups, though they could also do the job, I think, to break the old mold of our religious habits. And we look for stories that we can enter into and put ourselves personally into the roles of the disciples who walk proudly beside Jesus, and then not so proudly, and then very nervously, and then they fall asleep, and then they run away. Or we can simply join the crowd, which is easier. Cheering the young rabbi, everybody's friend, then calling for his execution, then jeering him when he dies. It's always more comfortable to join the stories of this Passion season with a little distance, one or two steps removed from Jesus, such as the intensity of the drama and the terror of it all. But we can't do that today, not in this first story of the season. There are only two characters, Jesus and the devil. This is close-up and personal stuff going down here. It's called The Temptation of Jesus, but it's also the temptation of each one of us if we dare to make the story our own and enter into it. But actually, it's more about testing than temptation. That's a better translation of the Greek word here. And just as God tested the people of Israel in their journey through the wilderness to the promised land, testing their faithfulness, testing their willingness to keep trusting and hoping and honoring the commandments. And that's why Jesus keeps quoting scripture to the devil, even though the devil has read it all before. In the same way, this story is about God testing us, testing our willingness to stay open and focused and alert to what the Spirit might be saying to us, what the Jesus model might be pointing us towards. And to stay open and focused, the first exercise in this spiritual training routine is to get rid of the rubbish that fills up our heads and hearts, that comes from the media-led, market-driven, consumer society all around us. A society that promises endless possessions, instant results, total control, even guaranteed peace of mind if you buy the right insurance. Try telling that to someone in Christchurch this week. All these promises form the great temptation, the great testing of our day. So if your house is earthquake-proofed and lifted above the 100-year flood level, if the food on your table is Heart Foundation ticked, if your workplace is OSH certified, if your savings are inflation-proofed and your pension fund is properly hedged, if you drive to the conditions and don't treat the speed limit as a target, if you keep spending and keep borrowing up to the limits the bank set for you, and if you're fully insured, then peace of mind and the good life is guaranteed. You will be in control of your life. Well, the journey through Lent to Easter is all about learning over again that that simply ain't true. The only way into that new life we are offered on Easter morning is to let go all these dreams of safety and control and guaranteed outcomes. In this testing encounter with this Bible-quoting-toting devil, Jesus says, thanks but no thanks, to this offer of instant results, of stones into bread, the promise of complete protection, the lure of endless possessions. We know all about these temptations. They're in our media and our own history. We're offered them every night in the ads for Powerball and Lotto and How to Be a Millionaire. I've got a stack of promises from Reader's Digest and Magna Mail that promises me the grand prize if only I subscribe and fill in the form today. The false promises are everywhere about us. The complete protection guarantee is woven into our missionary Christian history, with the Maori prophets like Te Ua assuring their followers that they would be bulletproof if they held up their hand and said the right prayer. We love these promises of instant results, but their lure runs deeper and deeper.